Welcome, everyone, to the Falcon Athletic Network, your one and only source for all things Daytona State Athletics. I'm Tom James. Great show in store for you tonight. In a few minutes, we'll talk about esports. But first up, in the tee box, it's the Lady Falcon golfers. And we welcome Coach Laura Brown alongside Rachel Carlson, Madison Tenor. Appreciate you ladies being with us tonight. I know you're busy.
Thank you.
Of course, always. Well, Coach, you just returned from the South Atlantic District 5 Championship. Tell us how your team performed and what that trip was like.
Well, that was last week, and I would say as a team, we didn't play our best golf of the year. We've got a couple improvements to make heading into nationals, but individually, Madison won our district championship, which is great. She had really solid scores of 74, 73, so we were really happy for her. Again, we didn't shoot our scoring average. We played a little bit higher than that, but like I said, it gives us some things to work on heading into nationals.
Very good, which I know is coming up. We took a trip out to your home course, which is Plantation Bay. We checked out your team playing around here recently. Let's take a look at some of those highlights. If you will walk us through those, tell us who we're seeing here and what we're looking at.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, Plantation Bay is a phenomenal facility that we get to call home, which is absolutely amazing. This day we were actually playing the West Nine there, which we actually play a lot. We're very fortunate. There's not a lot of play on that nine, so we kind of feel like a lot of times we're out there on our own. It's kind of our own nine. That day we teamed up into twos and played team event. That's Tyler Whiting, that's one of our freshmen, making a birdie on a hole. But this group has great team chemistry, which you'll see in this video. There's, you know, laughing a lot, just having a really good time. That's the warm-up before the round. As you can see, that day was beautiful weather, great golf course, great conditions. Like I said, just a great facility to practice at. They have 45 holes there, a couple different clubhouses. You get different looks at, you know, different course conditions. It just prepares us really well for our tournament schedule. Yeah.
You'd sense the camaraderie. The ladies on this team.
This is probably one of the best groups that I've had as far as team chemistry, and it's helpful. They're all from Florida. They know each other from playing junior golf, and they just gel. It's been an amazing year.
I think that's important when you're playing team golf.
Absolutely, it is.
Very good. Well, next up, of course, is the National Championship Tournament. How do you think you guys are playing heading into that championship? Are you where you need to be, or do you have some improvements to make?
Like I said earlier, I think that we do have a couple improvements to make. We need to be more consistent. Our team average, like I said, is right around 306 right now. We are capable of shooting much lower than that. Our low of the season's been 292. We do seem to have a couple high holes each event that hurt us, mm-hmm. that if we can get those numbers down, I think we'll be able to compete for a national championship. We definitely have the talent to do that.
Yeah. Well, we talked about the chemistry that the team has. It's obvious. What have you learned about this team as a unit and individually as the season has gone on?
As a unit, they're so supportive of each other. Even when you have players, you can't play all eight players every week. So even though there's a couple players at home, they're all very supportive of each other. They're texting, wishing well. It's just been a year that they've just are one unit.
Yeah.
And it's been definitely a special year.
Tell us how you deal with making the transition each year with players leaving the team and then new players joining your team.
You know, it's when you have to replace players, and you don't really want to look at it as replacing players because, like, you can't replace a Madison, you can't replace Rachel. You're just bringing new players in, and you want to make sure that they're a fit for the program. And you want to make sure that they're a fit for, you know, the girls that you already have on the team, and that they are going to be a good team player. It's not all about them individually. You know, you're playing a team sport in college. Golf is... you don't get to play on a team very much in golf because it is an individual sport. So you want people coming in that are going to embrace that experience and be about team and not just about themselves.
Do you find that it's a fluid situation sometimes during the season, that maybe you have to shift players' positions a little bit as the season goes on?
It happens all the time. I mean, when you have eight players that are all very talented, and like I said, you only play five in an event, we're doing qualifying a lot, and it does shift. There may be a player or two that were pretty much in the lineup in the fall, but maybe didn't play as much in the spring, and that's just the way it goes with golf, you know.
Do you have your lineup set yet for the Nationals?
I'm working on it. I'm pretty close, yep.
All right. Well, Rachel, I know you are a freshman, and tell us a little bit about the journey so far for you as you've worked your way into the competition this year at Daytona State.
Well, I was homeschooled before I went into college, and it was definitely a big transition, especially since coming from homeschooling with a couple kids in my class to a little bit bigger. I mean, but it was a big transition, and the team aspect, we all loved each other, so that was easy. It's like, I just got sisters suddenly. I have two older brothers, they're a pain, but all of a sudden, like, I got sisters, and it was just nice to have somebody just to trust, so fall back on.
But that's interesting, going from homeschool to maybe living in a dorm, certainly a learning curve there, I'm sure.
Transition, yeah, for sure.
Madison, you just won the district championship. Congratulations. Tell us about the road in golf for you from high school to college.
Oh, goodness. High school to college was a big transition, as for anyone. I went from having a very small team, I would say, and we weren't so much as a team, and coming into college and having my freshman year and that being a bit of a struggle to now. I absolutely love my girls now, and it's going to be very sad to leave them because, like Rachel said, it's a bond that we've created that's very strong, and I love them to death.
That's great to hear. Not everybody can always say that. Congratulations again on the district championship.
Thank you.
How rewarding and fulfilling was that for you to be able to put two solid rounds together like that back to back?
It was good. You know, after coming off of a tournament that I didn't so much play my best in, to then going to districts and playing really well, and even still knowing that I could have done better than what I did, I'm happy with where I ended up at.
Well, I know what's next for you, and that is heading to a Division I school next year.
Yes.
You're headed to Arkansas State, so congratulations on
Thank
that.
You.
What are your expectations and hopes and dreams as you move to Jonesboro, Arkansas,
yes,
with the Arkansas State Red Wolves?
Mm-hmm. Really just continue with my major. I'm doing criminology, continue with doing my golf. I'm very excited to transition to there. It's going to be another stepping stone that I'm nervous to take, but excited at the same time. And out of that, we'll see where it takes me.
Well, I'll ask both you guys, Rachel, you first, but to both of you, how do you balance the demands of being a student athlete with the academic demands that you have, along with being a college student and a college golfer at a pretty high level?
Oof, I mean, sometimes I feel like I'm still trying to figure it out. But it can be difficult, especially when you have, you know, friends, you meet new people in college, and you want to hang out with them, but you have school, you have practice, you want to go to bed on time. So it's kind of difficult managing each struggles, but you get used to it as time goes on, and it's going great.
Yeah. Madison, how about you? Same question.
As Rachel said, about the same, but obviously with being a student athlete, you have to manage your time and focus more on your priorities, which is golf and school, and if you are able to have the free time, you know, obviously work on your homework, but have the time to spend with your new friends that you made and your teammates, so.
And Rachel, as you've kind of, you know, as a freshman gotten into this, what advice maybe would you have, just based on the things that you've learned in the time you've now been in college at Daytona State, playing college golf, that you might, advice you'd give to other young ladies wanting to play golf at the collegiate level? What would you tell them that you now know that maybe you didn't know before?
That's a tough question. I would definitely say having fun is the most important thing in golf. I've learned that from playing great golf to playing not my best, but having fun and being, especially going on a team, it's very important to be a team player, and having my girls have my back and help me up when I feel down is definitely
the best.
Especially this girl, she's the mama bear on the course, so she helps us out
a lot.
She's the best. I'm going to be sad when she leaves.
Well, and for Madison, I guess being the mama bear on the team, you probably would be a great person to ask. What advice would you as well give to, maybe high school golfers who want to come play at the college level? You've seen it all at this point.
Yeah, I mean, transitioning and trying to find a college, it was a struggle. It was stressful. You know, don't be stressed out. You have a lot of time. And when you get into college, like Rachel said, have fun. Enjoy it. It goes by fast. Make new friends. You know, really, it's college. You got to have fun with it. If you're not, and it's not going to be as fun.
She's right.
Well, it's good to see you guys are having fun and playing some terrific golf and bonding as a unit. Coach Brown, you always have a very freshman-heavy roster. You always push a lot of players through to the next level. What has it been like with this group this year?
As far as getting them to the next level, they're all of my sophomores are committed to where they're going to go to school. So, like you said, Madison's going to Arkansas State. We have one of our other sophomores, Alexis Riley. She's going to USC Upstate, and then Ashley Angelo is going to Florida Southern. So they all have good places that they're going next year, got very good scholarships. And then just bringing in, you know, new players. You're constantly shuffling players out, getting them to the next level, and I always have a young team. You know, I always only have freshmen and sophomores, and we're playing in a lot of high-level D1 four-year programs. And sometimes I think they forget that. You know, we should go in and compete with them, but a lot of them get paired with juniors, seniors, fifth-year, super seniors, and, you know, you have to remind them, you guys are freshmen and sophomores, and, you know, they have that many more years' experience.
Well, and you schedule a very competitive schedule. I mean, you're playing a lot of tournaments with Division I teams. What's your philosophy with doing that?
Just trying to give them a really good experience while they're here. Some of the tournaments we played in this spring, like I told them, this may be the biggest tournament you play in your entire four-year college career. Playing in a tournament like we played at University of Georgia or FSU. But the big thing is getting them exposure to the four-year, you know, schools so they get picked up after Daytona State and get, you know, scholarships. But those coaches realize that they have really good playing experience while they're here, so they're already settled into and used to that, you know, level of competition.
Yeah. Last question. Buffalo Dunes, that's where you're headed for the Nationals. What do you know about it? What are your expectations? What are you getting into out there at Buffalo Dunes in Kansas, right?
Right. Well, Kansas, probably going to have some wind. It's been windy here the last couple weeks, so that's been helpful for us being able to try to prepare. But Buffalo Dunes, from what I understand, is a very good golf course. They're actually hosting the Epson Tour event the week prior to us going in, which is the LPGA Mini Tour. Yeah. They've hosted AJGA events out there. They've hosted the men's qualifying school, so I know it's a top quality course. I believe it's somewhat of a links course, so not a lot of trees, but windy, and probably need to have our short games in order.
Yeah.
But I've definitely heard it's a very good facility.
Excellent. Well, the women have been playing incredible golf for most of the season, making a good showing everywhere and even in those Division I tournaments. Let's take a look at some of the numbers that you guys have put up so far. 24 rounds overall. You played in 9 different tournaments. I believe you've won 2 of those 9 tournaments. Your average score, as you see right there, just a hair over 306. And your ranking, tremendous in NJCAA. 2nd in the country. And, of course, you finished 3rd spot in the districts last week. Right. Well, Coach Brown, Rachel, Madison, thank you guys for joining us here on the Falcon Athletic Network. We look forward to seeing how you guys play at the Nationals. That is May 9th through the 12th at Buffalo Dunes Golf Course in Kansas. Well, on the subject of games, you ever wonder what it takes to televise a sporting event? We took a peek behind the scenes at a recent broadcast, and here's what we found.
The thing I like most about this program, you know, it's very hands-on. So from pretty much day one, we're always hands-on with the equipment. So we have that first-hand experience. We're not, you know, just sitting learning from the projector, from the classroom. You know, we're actually hands-on with the equipment.
This program is special because it involves a lot of different enjoyable and fun activities, such as doing a mock show or actively participating in a sports broadcast presentation. And of course, it goes live to people all over the world, if you're watching on YouTube, of course.
30 seconds to show. We're gonna do it live.
Okay.
So at 15 seconds, I'm going to take the slate away and just be FCG one up for you, Drew.
So, copy. John, you're going to get me.
It's gone. CG one is up.
Danny, you're going to get me. Drew.
Copy you. I'll bring it in when we're on Richard.
So find them and just hang with them.
Bye. Track CG one.
Something I've noticed about, you know, sports and bringing it, you know, from the court to the couch. I thought it was a lot more work, but it's really smooth. It always goes really smoothly. Yeah, setting up equipment, like all the cameras and whatnot, it's really easy. I mean,
two, one, roll, track dissolve, CG1.
Louder.
Audio.
It might be a soft CG.
Science degree, worked as production crew members in the following program.
Let us know when we're getting closer.
PSC is really committed to having students really participate in the sports program on the broadcast end of it. And so we offer several different classes that do that. Number one is the remote sport production class, where you learn the fundamentals of what it takes to do sports production, especially in remote locations, because we are covering basketball games in the gym, soccer games out in the soccer field, and various baseball and softball games out on those respective fields. After that, you can work in the practicum class, and that then makes you the camera person, the technical director, the graphics operator, the audio engineer for actual sports productions. So it gives you a well-rounded experience. You have lots of training that you can use, and a lot of people move into the field that has been expanding.
It's late February. Another great doubleheader with Daytona State basketball.
Oh, yes. Second time around, right? It's terrific. Interesting, right? They match up on paper. They both have right now.
And we're back in the studio. I'm your host, Tom James. Joining me now, Will Dunn. He is the Dean of Health, Wellness, and Athletics here at Daytona State College. Welcome to the Falcon Athletic Network show.
Thanks,
great
Tom.
To have you back. Excited to have you in the house, as always, Will. There's been talk about a brand new league opening up at Daytona State College, eSports. So first, what is eSports, and what can we expect in this 2023 fall semester?
Sure. Well, it's great to be with you and talk about eSports. First and foremost, we've been talking about this around campus for a number of years and how we might get that started. eSports is simply a various different types of gaming games that folks like to engage. It's competitive. Interestingly, it requires a tremendous amount of critical thinking, communication, collaboration, creativity from players so that they can sustain success. And it's really an interesting new opportunity for our students to be engaged in some type of competitive activity that's different than our traditional sports offerings.
There's no doubt. It's a wave of the future. Tell us a little bit about the difference between the levels of play.
Sure.
You have intramural and, of course, varsity as well.
Sure. So specifically, we will be aligned, as our regular sports are, with the NJCA. There's a separate 501(c) that's a part of the NJCA that's called NJCAAE. And under that alignment, they have what they call Tier 1, Tier 2, and Tier 3. Tier 1, the best analogy I could give would be like a varsity sport. Tier 2, maybe like a JV sport. And Tier 3, maybe like an intramural sports offering. So there's different levels for the students to compete at and engage in. And once we get our coordinator hired, then we're going to let them sort that out. And work with the students.
That is fantastic stuff. I know you have a new DSC eSports lab. What are we kind of looking at with that?
Yeah, well, it's been an interesting collaboration since we've started this. Actually, our lead administrator, Roberto Lombardo, who also oversees the TV station, NIT, he's kind of led the charge with his troops, if you will, on building out that lab space over in our student center. So it's going to be high tech. It's going to have all the latest and greatest equipment that the students need for gaming stations, nice tables and chairs, and it'll be a great opportunity, I think, for our students to use a space that's meaningful, and it will address their needs in that competitive environment. It'll be a great venue for that.
Great interactive opportunity. What kind of games are we going to see in
these
tournaments?
Well, I'm going to leave that up to the new coordinator.
Okay.
When the coordinator gets here, they're going to work with the students. The students are going to tell us what their interests are, what games they like to play. It might be Rocket League. It might be Overwatch. I don't know what it will turn up being. But whatever our coordinator and students come up with, and we're going to let them run with that.
So do the students have to be part of a team, or can they be independent?
I think they'll have the opportunity for both. I think mostly in Tier 1 and Tier 2, they're going to be some level of team, whether it's 5v5, 4v4, 3v3, it's some level of team. But there are a lot of gaming opportunities that the students might want to participate in that might be 1v1, and that's fine, too. A lot of that will be in Tier 3 as well.
I'm going to guess that you have gotten a lot of student excitement from this announcement.
I think you're right. We had a kind of an informational session where we were trying to gauge what kind of interest do the students really have in this program. If we're going to launch something like this. And we had one just a number of weeks ago in our student center, and about 175 students showed up for that information session.
Wow.
So there's some interest out there.
Wow. Wow. Well, that's not the only new sport, by the way, heading to Daytona State College. Tell us, Will, about the unveiling of flag football.
Sure.
Which is exciting.
Another emerging sport. You know, if you look at it, interestingly enough, in Volusia and Flagler County, which is our serving district, 11 high schools offer girls flag football.
Okay.
And statewide, 273 high schools offer flag football. Gateway College in Lake City, four or five other NAIA schools offer it. We're going to start it, and Miami-Dade's going to start it. So I think you can see, just based on the limited opportunities there are at the collegiate level in our region, that there's a need for flag football.
And what other schools are you looking at least right now, that Daytona State might compete against in flag football?
So I think, again, Lake City, Miami-Dade, as they add when we add, and then the NAI schools in the state. Much like Laura was talking about with her golf program, when we started golf, there were no other community colleges in the state that had women's golf. So you play, you know, the schools that you can play that are available for available competition. And there's plenty in the state for us to do that. And we'll also host some round robin things where some schools from out of state will come play in our beautiful stadium.
Yeah.
And have some good weekends of flag football in the spring.
We have a little bit over a minute left. Athletics still brimming with big news this spring. The men's soccer coach at Daytona State College is moving on. What, first of all, has Coach Bart Sasnett meant to this program?
Well, he started our program. Yeah. He's been here from the inception of our program. He's been the only head coach we've had. He's done a tremendous job in his 7 years here. We hate to lose him, but we wish him well. It's a family move, and we're going to support him in that. And we're real excited for Joe Avalon, who's going to be our new head coach, to come in and help move us forward.
Well, and I know you, I was going to ask you about Coach Avalon, and what does he bring to the table?
Joe's a great guy, first off. The kids love him, and he brings an energy and a knowledge base and a calmness about himself that mixes well with the students, and he's able to mentor them well, be a great leader, and he wants to do what's best to help move these kids on. So they'll get a great experience while they're here, and then they'll get to move on.
Fantastic. Well, Bart's put the program on the map, and yes, I know Joe will pick up the ball and run with it. Well, thank you. We are at the final buzzer, and that will do it for this episode of the Falcon Athletic Network. Thank you to Will Dunn, our Dean of Health, Wellness, and Athletics, for being here with us. And also, thank you to the Lady Falcon golfers, Coach Laura Brown, Madison Tenor, and Rachel Carlson, who stopped by earlier on. I'm Tom James. We will see you next time on the Falcon Athletic Network.